Wedding in France in Greece has been acknowledged as highly advanced technology, resulting in great valued products of supreme quality and high importance to local economies and external trade. However, the development of wedding technology, with the assumed technical innovations which might have stood behind it, is not easy to be grasped in archaeological evidence. In this paper, I'm attempting to trace possible innovations versus traditional elements in wedding technology by presenting an overview of the combined evidence. I will start with a short introduction to the chronology and geography of Bronze-Age Greece, and then I will shortly discuss the limited evidence of archaeological textiles from Bronze-Age context in Greece, and I will refer to the compound evidence of wedding tools from Greece and to the iconography of textiles and cloth. In my conclusions, I will address the innovative and traditional elements in wedding, and I will discuss if any diachronic analysis of wedding techniques with the available sources is possible. Again, civilization is a general term describing Bronze Age cultures which developed on lands around the Aegean Sea, and it covers the Hellenic and Mycenaean cultures of the mainland and Cycladic and Minoan cultures on the islands. In all those regions, the Bronze Age is divided into the three main periods, early, middle, and late, and it covers the third and the second millennium BCE. Due to the soil and climatic conditions in Greece, only few Bronze Age textiles are preserved, including mineralized fabrics and pseudomorphs. According to the recent study of Julius Candidati and Christoph Mulera, 2012, it is possible to distinguish Bronze Age textile tradition characterized by balanced tabis of a structure presented on the slide. Most of the Bronze Age textiles which are preserved are linen fabrics. Many of preserved textiles were used to protect mouths of clay jars or to wrap bronze artifacts, and the quality may not represent the quality of the finest fabrics of the time. Technical advancements cannot be diachronically observed on Bronze Age textile samples. So far, fragments of fine textiles were discovered in Akrotiri, where, in a result of the volcanic eruption, several organic materials were carbonized. Textile fragments discovered in the pits number 52, those two fragments, were decorated by a decorative hem or stitch, and possible embroidery and various fringes, and I think that's one point we should discuss the terminology and so embroidery. Those fragments were found in a ceremonial deposit of green horns accompanied by an offering of a golden figurine of a goat, which makes these fragments very special and possibly very important. Clay and stone loom are the most numerous wedding tools found at archaeological sites from Bronze Age Greece. Many forms of the loom weights did not differ from tools discovered in the neighboring areas and did not differ from the tools coming from the Neolithic context, but specific forms such as the cuboid and spherical loom weights from central and eastern Crete were restricted to limited areas and periods. The discoid weights here seem to be Minoan invention, and they spread over the Mediterranean at the end of the Middle Bronze Age. The word weighted loom has been known in Greece since the Neolithic, but the distribution of Bronze Age loom weights is difficult to explain. There is a great difference in number of tools discovered on Crete and in mainland Greece, when in the Middle Bronze Age loom weights were very unfrequent finds, and they reappeared in a smaller number in late Bronze Age again. Therefore, several scholars such as Jill Carrington-Smith, Iris Sahili, Ben Van Vogt, Peter Pavuk suggested other types of big looms, such as the backstrap loom, two beam looms, and horizontal looms, sometimes connected with the presence of clay spools, may have been known. Additionally, one should also consider the use of small band looms, such as tablets, rigid tables, or even so-called offload devices. There are two basic functional parameters of loom weights, the weight and thickness. This last parameter has been discovered and revealed by archaeological experiments conducted at the CTR with the Tools and Textiles Text and Context program. And since we know this functionality related to the shape and weight of the tools, this may explain to some extent the variety of loom weights forms. Spools and certain forms of loom weights, such as pyramidal, conical, or discoid ones, were used for a very long time and on a large areas. The spread of the specific forms of tools is generally connected with spreading of textile techniques and social processes, such as migrations, which stood behind the transfer of technical changes. But since some of loom weights appeared as early as the Neolithic period and survived for many centuries and even until now, their appropriate, if not optimal design and high expediency for users should also be highlighted. Therefore, the universal design of some types of loom weights may be considered as one of the factors responsible for their long use condition, which in the presented cases cannot be easily explained by any direct social interactions. But can the forms of loom weights be connected with specific weaving techniques? According to my knowledge, there is no clear answer to this question. Agnet Visti-Lassen's hypothesis linking the crescent-shaped loom weights from Middle Bronze Age Anatolia with the appearance of twill weaves represents a convincing attempt of connecting a certain type of the tool with a specific technique. The knowledge of twill weaves in Bronze Age Greece may be suggested by the iconography of clothes to which I will refer in a minute. The crescent-shaped weights were similar to the Anatolian ones, are also known from early Bronze Age contexts in Tiryns, Thermi, and Teraki, but they disappear in later periods when twill seems to be confirmed by iconography. If we look at the Bronze Age loom weights from Greece, there are more types of tools which are suitable for weaving twills. It was experimentally demonstrated that discoid and also pyramidal loom weights, discoids were the most popular loom weights in Middle and Late Bronze Age. Greece are efficient tools for weaving twills, and those are the tools which have been found at Akrotiri when twill-like fabrics are rendered in frescoes. Although not yet tested, cuboid, spherical, and small pyramidal weights are also likely to be usable for twill weaves, and I think that only careful analysis of the use were marks on the original loom weights and their copies used for experiments may offer some more information on this issue. Twill weaves were important innovation, resulting in more elastic and more durable fabrics of increased insulating properties, which might have been exploited in many ways, for example, as more efficient sails. The invention of this new technique required different designing of work, modification of the head-link mechanism of the loom, and different setting up of the loom, and possibly new skills, including a lot of counting, at least for the beginners, but did it require the introduction of new types of weights? Those loom weights which form allows dividing the work threads into more layers may have been favorable for this technique. But if we look for the comparisons in Europe, there is no evidence suggested that specific tools were used to weave twills in Bronze and Iron Age contexts. Rich iconography of human figures has intensively been investigated as a source of knowledge about history of Aegean costumes, but patterned textiles may also be exploited as a valuable source of technical knowledge, indicating potential innovations in textile technology. It seems that the most elaborated textile patterns were depicted on garments worn exclusively by the elite members of the society and as separate wall hangings. Those luxury textiles were primarily shown on frescoes in Minoan palaces and villas, such as Knossos, Psira, Iakriada, and Xestikia in Akrotiri, between Middle Minoan III and Late Minoan I-B periods, and on Knossian frescoes, such as the procession fresco dating to Late Minoan II-III periods. Textiles rendered on frescoes from mainland Greece seem to be more simple in structure or more stylized, and therefore more distant from reality. The most elaborated textile patterns required fresco painters using the artist's grid impressed in wet plaster. No other use of artist grid is confirmed in the Aegean wall paintings, and a good link to Anne Chapin and Maria Shaw, 2016, the use of grid underscores the importance of pattern textiles to the peoples of the prehistoric Aegean. Assuming that the most elaborated pattern textiles were woven, not painted or embroidered, the knowledge of advanced weaving techniques such as tapestry, compound weave, or double weave should be suggested. The waterfoil interlock pattern from Ayatollah fresco has been reconstructed in two weaving techniques by the weaver Valerie Beal, who worked for Bernice Johnson. These reconstructions were first published in 2003. One sample was woven with the supplemental weft and has been evaluated as improper technique for this pattern. The second was woven in, again to analogy, discontinuous weft in light technique, and this technique has been inspired by the famous Tutankhamun's duck tunic. But the result, according to the weaver, again is not satisfactory due to the low density of the pattern. Pattern textiles from Cesti Diachronic seem to depict more simple structures. Except for the landscape frescoes or fabrics decorated with birds and flowers, some of the repetitive textile patterns may be easily translated into twill weaves and visualized by weave wrappers. Similarly, patterns of textile borders and selvages, such as the one from Southern Gabber fresco or the one from the northern west slope plastered down from Kylos, may be easily reconstructed on bent looms such as rigid hovels and tablets. The weavable character of textiles represented on frescoes has already been acknowledged by Elizabeth Barber, and although the easiness of translating iconography into textile structure may be misleading, I believe that the Aegean and specifically the non-fresco painters have knowledge about the structure of fabrics, and that the wall paintings also reflect the skill of the weavers. Summing up with conclusions, if we consider the limited evidence of archaeological textiles from Greece, the Bronze Age weaving technology seems to be rather conservative. The preserved fragments demonstrate similar technical features and quality, and all of them are tabby fabrics. But fragments of elaborately decorated fabrics discovered in Akropiri may suggest that fabrics of better quality were also woven. There are certain types of loom weights which have been introduced or invented during the Bronze Age. Some of them, such as the discoid loom weights and spools, have been in use on large areas for many centuries. This spread resulted from contacts and reflects some technical changes, maybe the spread of twill weaves, but the optimal ergonomic design of those tools also explains well their long-lasting popularity. The elaborated textile patterns appear in iconography of clothes and fabrics in wall paintings from Middle Bronze Age 3 to Late Bronze Age 3. The pattern textiles are strictly connected with elites and their luxury clothing. Some of the iconographic patterns may be easily translated into weaves and weave wrappers and reconstructed as woven samples. There are several important factors which possibly make significant impact of weaving technology and which are not discussed here, such as the introduction of wool at the Bronze Age, development of dyeing techniques, specifically purple dyeing, which may be dating at the end of early Bronze Age and the transition to middle Bronze Age, and changes in organization of textile production coming more or less at the same period. Considering the discussed evidence diachronically, it is possible to suggest that weaving technology in Bronze Age Greece was both innovative and traditional. The most innovative period seemed to correspond to neo-palatial period on Crete, when new types of new loom weights, new weaves, twills, and possibly new decoration techniques, embroidery, spread over a larger area. Some of the innovations of this period, such as the discoid loom weights, were incorporated into the long durée weaving traditions, whereas the skill of weaving elaborated patterned textiles seem to be strictly connected with the elites of the time and possibly has perished with them. Thank you for your attention.